Hi, this is Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting video 6.2 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video discusses about how to interpret the coronary angiogram. Coronary angiography is the sixth of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention and is performed after engagement of the catheter is achieved. There are 8 steps to performing the angiogram. Steps 1 through 7, which have to do with obtaining the images, were discussed in detail in video 6.1. And in this video, we'll discuss about specifically how to interpret the coronary angiogram. The first question before proceeding with the interpretation is to check whether the quality of the images is good to allow a sufficient interpretation. These are examples of angiograms that are of poor quality, because there is poor filling of the coronary artery due to suboptimal engagement. In such cases, interpretation is impossible because there is no complete opacification of the lumen of the coronary artery. So for the angiogram to be interpretable, there should be good opacification of the coronary artery. There should be contrast coming back into the aorta to allow us to check for ostial stenosis. And also, all coronary segments should be assessed in orthogonal projections. Here is an example where the visualization is poor, the opacification is poor, and the LAD is cut out, so we cannot really provide an assessment of the mid and distal LAD. Moreover, each coronary artery should be assessed in at least 2 orthogonal projections. And this will be discussed in more detail later on. So for the angiogram, there are 13 components that are assessed. The first one is coronary flow. And coronary flow is assessed using the TIMI grading system. There are 4 grades, TIMI 0, 1, 2, and 3. TIMI 0 essentially means complete occlusion without undergrade flow past that area of the stenosis. TIMI 1 means that there is flow past the area of the stenosis, however, the flow does not reach all the way to the end of the coronary artery. TIMI 2 means that there is flow all the way to the end of the coronary artery, however, the speed of flow is slower than the contrast flow speed in a contralateral coronary artery. And finally, TIMI 3 is normal undergrade coronary flow. The speed in the area affected by the stenosis is the same as the speed of contrast flow in an unaffected artery. This is an example of a TIMI 0. There is no flow past the circumflex. After balloon angioplasty, there is now TIMI 1 flow, some contrast penetration, but does not reach all the way to the end of the artery. And then after stenting, there is now TIMI 3 flow. There is good undergrade flow all the way to the end of the artery with the same speed as the flow in the non-involved LAD. After assessing the coronary flow, the second assessment is whether there are and how severe they are any stenosis in the coronary tree. To provide an adequate interpretation, the operator has to have a mental representation of what the expected coronary anatomy should be. For example, in this case, we see an obvious significant lesion in the origin of this branch, which is the ramus. However, this is the left main and we do not see an LAD. Therefore, here there is 100% occlusion of the ostium of the LAD, in addition to a severe, about 90% stenosis of a large ramus branch and also an occlusion in the circumflex branch. So all the visualized arteries, or even not visualized, should be commented on the angiographic report. The severity of the lesion is reported by percent diameter stenosis, and this has to do with the diameter at the area of the stenosis in relationship to diameter in the proximal and distal reference segment. This is how this is done. The minimum lumen diameter is assessed, and then we assess what percent this represents in relationship to the average of the proximal and the distal reference diameter. In this example, let's say that this is a 1 millimeter minimum lumen diameter and this is a 5 millimeter vessel. That would be 80% diameter stenosis. To provide a good assessment of the severity of the stenosis, it is critical to have visualization of the coronary artery in 2 orthogonal projections. And this is why some coronary lesions can be eccentric. This coronary lesion does not show at all in this superior projection. However, it is very evident in this lateral projection. So orthogonal projections of every coronary artery are key, and we always report the percent diameter stenosis in the most severe projection. Usually 70% diameter stenosis is the cutoff for calling a lesion significant. However, this is not perfect because we know from the FAME and other studies that the percent diameter stenosis does not always correlate perfectly with the hemodynamic significance of the lesion. For example, these are lesions with 71 to 90% stenosis. However, several of them have an FFR more than 0.80, suggesting that these lesions are not hemodynamically significant. Vice versa, we have here lesions less than 70%, so one would not expect them to be significant. However, several of those lesions were significant by FFR. Another key piece of information before providing an assessment of the coronary artery is to know whether nitroglycerin was given. This is an example where there is multifocal spasm. There are multiple lesions in the coronary artery, but these lesions resolve after nitro is given. And that is why every angiogram should be done after nitro is administered to avoid false calling of stenosis that are not there present but just represent spasm. After assessing the TIMI flow, the stenosis, the estimated lesion length in millimeters, the next characteristics looking for is thrombus. Normally, there should be no filling defects within a coronary artery. This is an example of thrombus as a round filling defect. This is discussed in more detail in chapter 20. This is another example of a round filling defect in a patient with acute myocardial infarction that also represents thrombus. Sometimes the differentiation between thrombus and a complete occlusion that is chronic can be challenging, and there are several criteria that can be used, such as the correspondence to areas of ST elevation, wall motion abnormalities, filling defects suggestive of thrombus. Sometimes there's contrast retention within the thrombus. And all these characteristics can help determine if there is thrombus or if this is a chronic occlusion. This is the case shown earlier on. This was a large filling defect that was a thrombus that was successfully aspirated, followed by stenting and restoration of TIMI 3 flow in the right coronary artery. Another characteristic of the coronary arteries is the presence of calcium. Normally, the coronary artery is not visible under X-ray before contrast is given, because the density of the coronary wall and the blood flowing inside is similar to the density of the surrounding tissues. However, if there is calcification of the wall, then the coronary artery can be seen before contrast is administered, as is the example in this case that has significant calcium as well as previously placed stents. This is another example where the right coronary artery is well visualized before contrast is administered because of the presence of severe calcification. And the definition of severe calcification by angiography is dense radiopacities on both sides of the arterial wall. Importantly, coronary angiography is actually fairly insensitive for detecting calcification. Intravascular imaging is much more sensitive. Moving on, the coronary arteries can have dissections that are either spontaneous or iatrogenic. There is the NHLBI classification of the severity of dissection, ranging to a small luminal haziness, to a linear dissection, to a complete occlusion of the vessel. This is an example of dissection in the LAD, the circumflex, as well as aortocoronary dissection going backwards. And this is why the pressure waveform should be assessed very carefully before injecting contrast, because injection of contrast against dampened waveform can lead to coronary dissection. Sometimes coronary dissection can be spontaneous. This is such an example that usually happens in women in the peripartum period, but can happen in other patients as well. SCAD also can sometimes have multifocal involvement. Number 7 of the characteristics looking for is the presence of bifurcation lesions, which are lesions where the coronary arteries split into branches. This is an example of an LAD and diagonal bifurcation lesion. Bifurcations are usually assessed by using the Medina classification. This is discussed in detail in the videos from chapter 16. Characteristic 8 is the presence of lesion at the beginning of the vessel. This is an example of such a lesion at the ostium of the right coronary artery. There's a specific video on this on chapter 15. These lesions can sometimes be missed if there's no contrast going back in the aorta. That is why it is critical for every angiogram that the injection of contrast is sufficient to allow backflow into the aorta. Also, there is possibility of dampening of the pressure when there are ostial lesions, and that is why contrast injection should be done carefully to avoid causing an ostial dissection. Ostial lesions can be either aorto-ostial at the origin of the coronary vessels or the bypass grafts, or can be branch-ostial such as LAD diagonal bifurcations. Characteristics number 9 is tortuosity, which has to do with the presence of bends in the coronary artery. This is an example of extreme tortuosity with multiple bends. These lesions can be challenging to wire and deliver equipment to, and this will be discussed in more detail in chapters 8 and 9. Characteristic 10 is aneurysm. Aneurysms are defined as coronary artery diameter more than 1.5 times the reference diameter. Clearly here we have an aneurysm in the proximal right coronary artery. Case 80 in the PCIU manual provides such a case that was treated with implantation of a covered stent. Characteristic 11 is collateral flow. This is common in patients with CTO, such as this one. When there is no undergrade flow, quite often the body creates this collateral circulation that provides blood flow to the area distal to the coronary occlusion. There is different classification for this that is relevant for CTO intervention to determine whether these collaterals are suitable for the retrograde approach in which wires are advanced through those collaterals and the CTO is crossed against the original direction of flow. Here's an example of not really a collateral, but what could be a collateral. This is filling of the LAD, and then there is retrograde filling in the lima and the arm, and the reason for this finding is significant proximal subclavian stenosis. This is an example of subclavian steel. Number 12 is perforation. The contrast should flow in the coronary artery. The contrast should not go out. This is an example of a large vessel perforation in the mid-right coronary artery. This is critical to find quickly in cases of percutaneous coronary intervention because any delay can cause tamponade and be lethal. There are different types of coronary perforations that are classified based on the location of the perforation as well as the severity, and this will be discussed in detail in chapter 26. These are the four types of perforation: large vessel perforation, distal wire perforation, and perforation in collaterals that have to do with CTO interventions. And last, there are sometimes fistulas, which are connections between the coronary artery and other structures. This is an example of a fistula going from the LAD into the pulmonary tract. These fistulas are infrequent, but sometimes if there is significant flow, they can form the focus for endocarditis, and sometimes may need to be occluded either percutaneously or surgical. So in summary, there are several characteristics that are assessed in the coronary arteries in every coronary angiogram. Before proceeding with interpretation, it is critical to ensure that the technique is excellent with good opacification of all coronary vessels in at least two orthogonal projections and backflow of contrast in the aorta. Then those 13 characteristics are assessed to provide an accurate picture of the coronary tree, and this coronary anatomy then forms the basis for making plans for possible coronary revascularization. Thank you.